I looked at his journals, and I'll read you a couple lines. As we're saved only by the accomplishment of Christ's sacrifice on the cross, so we live each day by faith, the same faith by which we were saved. We are always dependent on Christ's death that saves and keeps us. So with that little truth, he discipled those people. And what I would like to do is, this morning, walk through these verses and ask you, as I've asked myself all week long, what part of my life, of my behavior, of my attitudes, have I examined and seen that they are not Christ-like? And not just mentally, just kind of done a little inventory, but what parts of my life have I said, Lord, I want you to work on this. I want you this week to make me, verse 5, have less of my members which are involved in things that displease you. Verse 8, I want less of my attitudes to reflect these un-Christ-like attitudes. And I want more of verse 12. I want more of you to transplant into me. You know, modern medicine, we not only take out the bad parts, we put in good parts, right? They're transplanting hearts, and they're transplanting kidneys, and they're transplanting all these different things. And it's very much medically what God wants to do spiritually. He wants to transplant into us, verse 12, the very attitudes of Christ. So sanctification, as we'll see verse by verse, is the process of becoming Christ-like, of growing in holiness. It began the instant we were converted, and it won't end till we meet Jesus face to face. And through the work of His Spirit, through the power of the Word of God, and through the ministry of other believers. Now, I'm going to challenge you in this way this morning. God put us all into groupings. If you're married to a believer, you have a natural accountability partner that you might not even be using fully to God's glory. If you were born into a Christian family, you have if you have believing parents, you have a couple of the greatest disciplers that could ever disciple you because they know you better than anybody else. And if you're not in a Christian marriage, and if you're not in a Christian home, then you have a church full of saints that would love to encourage you to do these things. You know what happens to most of us? We try and do this all by ourselves, and we're like two little islands. Us with our husband or wife, us with our parents living in the same house, we're all trying to accomplish the same things, be Christ-like. If you're saved, you should be wanting to do that. But we're doing it without the encouragement, the prayers, and the help of those around us. So we'll get to that in just a moment. But sanctification renews our mind. As God peels away our desires for sin, it's all about the choices and behavior. It involves work on our part. As we're empowered by God's Spirit, we strive, we fight sin, we study Scripture, we run hard, we pursue holiness. That's what sanctification is all about. It's about us making choices. Starting in verse 1, since you were raised with Christ, that's justification. The rest of the chapter is about sanctification. Seek those things which are above. We saw that last week. Verse 2, set your mind on things above. And if you have trouble, even now, some of you, your mind's wandering off to the movie you saw yesterday. You're wandering off to what you're going to do this afternoon. You know, go out to have fun. If you really want to listen this morning, you know what you can do right where you're sitting? Say, Lord, verse 2, set my mind on your things. Because you saved me, I know you can sanctify me. I need my mind focused in. I'm only in here for an hour a week, and I need to listen to this. You have to consciously ask the Lord to tune you in and to cast down imaginations and everything that confuses us and bring every thought into captivity to Christ. That's what verse 2 is about. Verse 5, put to death your members. Remember, we talked about that last Sunday. Verse 8, put off. Paul says there are certain things you have to strip yourself. The word he uses for putting off clothes, it's a picture from the life of the early Christians. When they were baptized, they would tear off their old dirty clothes. They'd go down into the water. And then when they came up out of the water, the church members would provide them with a brand new white raiment, a robe to put on, which was a picture that in Christ we're buried and the old life goes down to the grave with Him, and the new life is what we come out to live. But that sanctification process is repeated day by day as we have to strip off all those things that are mentioned in verse 8. Anger and wrath or rage, as the NIV puts it, malice, blasphemy or slander, cutting down other people, filthy language out of our mouth. Now verse 9, don't lie to one another. because you put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man, verse 10 says. Now, verse 11 is very significant. Where there is neither Jew nor Greek, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian. That's an interesting word. I read about that. I won't tell you everything I read because they were the most horrific people of the ancient world. But barbarians, the word barbar just means they weren't a Greek. They were heathen. Scythians, though, were the worst barbarians. Scythia is in the area we would call the Caucasus Mountains, around the Caspian Sea, you know, where they're making all the oil and gas discoveries now, and they're building all those pipelines. That's the Caucasus Mountains. Now you say, why do you even think about that? Well, let me describe them, and then I'll tell you who their descendants are, okay? Let me describe the barbarians called the Scythians. They were brutal, mean heathen. When they captured their enemies, they scalped them, kind of like, you know, the Native Americans used to do. And they would use their skull as a cup and would drink the blood of the victim from their own skull. I can't think of anything more barbaric than that, okay? And so these people lived in the Caucasus Mountains. Have you ever filled out a form and it said gender, male, female? And then next it would say, are you a Caucasian? Caucasian. Caucasus Mountain person. These people were known as white-skinned people. That's why they're called Caucasians. The Scythians were Caucasians. Are you a Caucasian? Look where you've come from. Do you still scalp people? Do you cut their heads off and drink their blood? That's why. Look what he says here. He says, verse 9, you have put off the old man with his deeds, you Caucasians. You put on the new man, renewed in knowledge according to the image of him, where there's neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian. These barbaric, horrible, murderous people, slave or free. No, you're new. Christ is all and in all. Did you know, every time I fill out a federal form, I think about that. When I look at that Caucasian, I think, yeah, I was one of those. I'm not anymore. I am new in Christ. I'm not a barbarian. I'm not a Scythian. I am new in Christ, and Christ is all in all.